You want a glass of water? Some cookies? We may be here a while. This is Who Killed Teresa. Episodes of what has turned out to be now a 7-part podcast on the 1969 unsolved murder of 14-year-old Teresa Martin. Many of you wrote to me or commented that the prime suspect in the case should be one-time Satan's choice biker, a biker named Mike French. And that the tattoo inscription found on Martin's stomach, F.L. Frenchie, I love you, must be a reference to French, either inscribed by him as some sort of sick joke, or possibly implicating him by someone else as a way to throw authorities off the trail of what would have been the real killer. Montreal writer Christian Gravner guessed this on the Facebook page for this podcast. A listener with some affiliation with Montreal's West End gang also guessed this. I considered this early on before deciding that it seemed too obvious. There's this press release, and I'll put it on the website, teresalore.com, teresalalore.com. So there's this press release, and it must be from 1970, probably just after February 1970, when the Sûreté du Québec took over the case. And we can see now that the inscription carved on Teresa Martin read, or the SQ wanted the public to believe it read, F.L. Frenchie, I love you. In some confusion with the L, was it a V? Wasn't it L? It appears to have been an L. This notice summarizes that Martin was a young student, that she was found dead on the 13th of September, 1969, near a tavern on Henri Bourassa Boulevard in Montreal North, and that any cooperation on the part of the public would be considered an act of civic duty aiding the justice system. Okay. Okay, sure. What I can tell you now is that Mike French, as a suspect, is one of the theories that the current cold case investigators with the Sûreté du Québec maintain as a possible explanation for Martin's bizarre and puzzling murder. Specifically, I was told that the one-time head of the cold case unit, Marc Lapin, developed this theory in his early work as a criminal profiler. And according to Le Pin, the F stood for French, the L stood for a second biker, someone named Lenin. We're not sure who Lenin was, and that they were both members of Satan's Choice with, quote, no attachment to Montreal North. Apparently, Le Pin came to this conclusion in 2007. Given the date, 2007, I think it needs to be taken with a grain of salt, maybe a pound of salt. From what I know of Le Pin, and I know a fair bit, he made his bones on the Guy Croutot case. He's currently in charge of major crimes with the SQ. But in In 2007, he would have just barely completing his profiling training with the FBI. And coming up with the offender profile for Teresa Martin's case, this would have been one of his very first profilers. And my thoughts on that have been, I hope he's got more information to go on than simply the word French. And my confidence here didn't increase when I was told that Le Pen also believed that Martin's murderer must have, quote, cared for her because, quote, she wasn't dumped but gently put down to be found. I think the actual quote, she wasn't dumped in some field. She was left in the parking lot to be found. Le Pen must have forgotten about the knocks to the back of Martin's head. You know, I just give the information. Anyway, when did Mike French ever care about anyone but himself? The one other murder that we've covered here where he's a suspect is the abduction and brutal killing of 16-year-old Sharon Pryor. Pryor was found raped, beaten, possibly gagged, and held and tortured for several days, then strangled, then dumped in a field in Longueuil, April 1st, 1975. Pryor disappeared after leaving her Congregation Street home on the way to a Point Saint-Charles pizza joint. And at that time, bikers, presumably Satan's Choice, had a club or a clubhouse one block north of her home on Rue Sebastopol. A little about Mike French. The best source for what we know about Mike French comes from Christian Gravner's website about Montreal subculture, Coulopolis. Allegedly, French grew up at the Weirdale House, a home for troubled boys located in Westmount. And at an early age, French joined the Satan's Choice Biker Club from Saint-Henri, the Saint-Henri chapter. I think their headquarters in the 60s, 70s was right in Little Burgundy, just in that area. Saint-Henri is across from the Lachine Canal. It's across from Point Saint-Charles. Satan's Choice was one of the clubs targeted by Montreal Community Outreach Officer John Dalzell in the late 1960s. It's one of the clubs he wanted to come in his establishment of his Federation of Motorcycle Gangs, Le Muck. If you need more information on Le Muck, I have the link posted to the website, which will take you back to episode 4, which is all about the Muck. I believe it's 4. In the early 1970s, Mike French was possibly living for a period in Beaconsfield at 67 Portland Place, possibly with a relative named Thalon French. And we know this because they were listed as defendants in a property dispute in the Quebec Provincial Courts in February 1975. And this Portland Place apartment was right along the lakeshore. Not far from the lakeshore. Somebody explain this to me. Like, we call it the lakeshore, but it's on the St. Lawrence River. It's not on a lake. We call it the National Library. But it's not a national library. It's a provincial library. Well, we know why that is. Let's not get into that. Anyway, where he lived on the lakeshore, it's not far from the Maples and the Edgewater clubs French was known to frequent. My sister Teresa in the day also went to those places on weekends, as everyone did, really. So it's quite possible that my sister encountered Mike French on some occasions, though we're not building to that. I wouldn't read much into that. Yeah, French was known to be an erratic, violent man, but there's many people who encountered him at that time, who observed that he was often inclined to simply, you know, sit at a bar, have his beer, and then just quietly leave the place, except when he wasn't. In 1977, Michael French was charged along with five others in an incident involving injury with intent to maim or mutilate. John O'Donnell described to the court how a peaceful evening out in Montreal with a group of friends turned into a nightmare of violence. And this is John O'Donnell on the witness stand. It only took about 15 seconds. One of them stabbed my two friends in the stomach. Then somebody hit me in the face with a heavy object like a beer stein. I was knocked on the ground, had one tooth broken, and another knocked out. French's longtime partner in crime, Bobby Chow, was singled out as the guy who did the stabbing. Rounding out this crew were Brian Powers, Kevin O'Brien, and Tom, and Ed O'Neill. All well-known, notorious members of Satan's Choice. O'Donnell required 12 stitches to close the gash in his face. Christian Gravner goes on in great detail about this incident and about Bobby Chow. Again, I put the link up on the webpage to his Coolopolis stuff. And this fight occurred at the old Mustache Club, across from the Montreal Forum. For a time, Mike French had been living at 5870 Sherbrooke West. So it's an apartment in NDG, and we know this because on November 11th, 1970, it's reported French was charged with armed robbery over an argument about the purchase of some hash. So 1970 is closer to our target, 1969 and Teresa Martin. And what's also interesting here is that NDG is inching closer to Point St. Charles, the neighborhood where Sharon Pryor lived. And finally, in 1982, there's a simple obituary in the Montreal papers informing us that Michael French died on November 12th. And at the time, he had several brothers and sisters living in Montreal, Calgary, Port Coquitlam, and apparently a wife named Madonna. How and why did French die? The rumor goes like this. French was murdered because he boasted once too often about raping and killing Sharon Pryor in the spring of 1975. According to Gravner, police suspected West End gang hitman Jackie McLaughlin killed French, chopped him into pieces, and deposited the remains across the St. Lawrence River in Kahnawake. You know, we're just simply going to have to put up with the fucking crow. You know, I swear to you, I lost 30 minutes having a Seth Brundle moment, for fuck's sakes, chasing a fly around in here. So we're just... just consider it like the raven or something like that, that it's an ill portent what's coming, and just live with the fucking crow, okay? So the rumor is Sharon Pryor, or he French killed Sharon Pryor. Somebody extracts retribution, and they dump his remains in Kahnawake as a sort of community service. Other versions go like this: that he was killed not for killing Sharon Pryor, but for raping the daughter of a cop or possibly a mafia boss. What grabbed my attention most in all of this was Mike French being a member of Satan's Choice and a gang rape that took place in 1968 by 12 to 23 Satan's Choice members. On October 24th, 1968, a 15-year-old girl was taken by Satan's Choice gang leader Richard Bernie Gwinden to a clubhouse at 22 Willow Street in Ottawa. She first had voluntary sex with Gwinden. Then, after being beaten, she was forced to have sex with the rest of the members. And this is from an article in the Ottawa Citizen. He took her to an old shack where a guy called Wheeler said, "Splash." When she refused the group aberration, she was beaten, stripped, and forced to undergo intercourse with all the males there, about 23. There are several things of interest here for our purposes. A clubhouse that is an old shack, provocative, the use of the word splash. But in addition, there was a young woman involved in the tormenting of this 15-year-old victim, a 19-year-old female member of the Satan's Choice named Lorraine Cotty participated in the assault, kicking the 15-year-old girl in her face with steel-tipped cowboy boots. Initially, this 19-year-old girl was also charged with rape, but the sentence was reduced to assault, causing bodily harm when she agreed to testify against the men. Cotty described how she traveled to the clubhouse from Toronto with Bernie Gwinden, who was her husband. And once then, Gwinden's plan was to prostitute his wife for club members. On the witness stand, Cotty was asked to describe the role women play in Satan's Choice. And she says, "They have no status. They're pigs. They are treated just like pigs. We have no say, nothing to say about anything. You're just there. If you're ordered to do something, you do it." Cotty went on to describe how she was forced by Gwinden to hit the girl more than once. "I hit her with my fists and with my boots. Then they forced her to do just about everything." Other witnesses testified how they saw the 15-year-old girl at the clubhouse sweeping up the living room. A club member described her as, quote, "our new splasher," end quote. The horrific scene only came to light when the brave girl finally decided to tell a neighbor of her ordeal the day after her assault. On May 25th, 1969, five members of the Ottawa chapter of Satan's Choice, including Gwinden, were found guilty of indecent assault on the 15-year-old girl. They had initially been charged with the more severe offense of rape. The judge handed down the maximum sentence of 5 years and commented that he would have imposed the lash if such a penalty were available. Richard Bernie Gwinden. This is no, you know, small-time biker stooge guy, right? He founded Satan's Choice in Toronto in 1965. And if you check any biker or a Wikipedia page, you'll find little about Bernie's orchestrated gang rape of a 15-year-old girl. It's explained away as a police frame-up, or anyway, Bernie thought she was 18. There are paragraphs, books out there devoted to how great Bernie was and the biker code and wars with rival gangs. According to one author, Mick Lowe, to be around Bernie Gwinden was to feel utterly and irrepressibly alive, living for the moment and yet moving towards some grand and glorious future. Is that how the raped and beaten 15-year-old girl felt? Irrepressibly alive? The acclaimed Canadian film director Donald Shabib, most known for the movie Down the Road, he further glorified Gwendolyn in his 1965 biker documentary Satan's Choice. You know, today Bernie Gwendon's still out there living the dream. He's probably holed up in some shithole cottage in St. Agathe or the Muskokas or something. It's galling. The glorification of folks like Gwendon continue to this day. Somebody wrote another book about him a couple of years ago, and you know it. It all begins with this hard scrapple tale, right? Where apparently Bernie borrowed 25 cents from his mom. His mom said, well, you can have 25 cents if you beat the shit out of your brother. And this is supposed to be how we learn of Gwendon's early entrepreneurial skills, no matter how dark and colored they are. It reminded me of, you know, the old Pierre Pelladeau story, where allegedly he borrowed $1,500 from his mom and bought a printing press, I believe, turned that into a multi-million-dollar media empire. Despite they're both controversial figures, and despite some of my misgivings about Pierre Pelladeau. The Pelladeaus, by the way, currently own the Journal de Montréal, just to recall. With the exception of that early parable of entrepreneurism, that's where the comparison between a Bernie Gwendon and a Pierre Pelladeau ends. Pelladeau is a fascinating character. Opinionated, controversial, unpredictable, funny. So where Pelladeau is all of these things, Bernie Gwendon is none of them. Lorraine Cotty's account of this gang rape raises the possibility that girls and women may have participated or at least witnessed the ritualistic tattooing of Teresa Martin and her asphyxiation. Whether that possible participation was willing or unwilling is a matter of further speculation, but it raises the prospect that the witness, Joanne H., not the witness to Martin's murder, the witness who was interrogated by the Quebec coroner, Laurent Lapointe, and Crown Prosecutor Roche Herreau, that she may have known much more than she revealed in that interrogation. When Cotty describes the rape, what she describes is a more graphic version of what Joanne H. alludes to in her testimony, where the term splash is used vaguely by Joanne H. We are given the full extent of its meaning by Cotty. A splasher is a sex slave. Cotty's participation in all of this is murky. It's unclear. At one moment, we were told she was a gang member, and then by her account, she was forced into prostitution and beating of the girl. There's an account from May 1970 that kind of informs all of this, where an 18-year-old girl who is identified as a member of Satan's Choice participated in a ritual beating, quote, it's called a, quote, ritual beating of another gang member, another Satan's Choice member. So while this beating victim, a kid named Bobby Anderson, endures 3 hours of whipping, beating, and torture, The girl laughed and cheered on his two tormentors. One of these gang members is identified as 21-year-old Yvonne Robert of 6422 Rue Beaucourt in Montreal North. Recall, this is May 1970. So this is like 6 or 8 months after Teresa Martin's murder. And curiously, Yvonne Robert, who is a Satan's Choice gang member, he resided in a house nestled right between Boulevards Leger and Henri Bourassa. He's a 3-minute drive from the tavern where Teresa Martin was found, and a 4-minute drive from Teresa Martin's home. A guy who was a gang member who participated in taking a guy to a secluded location and beating and torturing him, cheered on, you know, in this bloodlust manner, by this 19-year-old girl who was herself a Satan's Choice gang member. This stuff is dense, and I wrote it down. So if you're like, and I do it. So we got a 15-year-old girl, we got a 14-year-old girl, we got a 19-year-old girl, and I even have problems tracking it. So if you need to go back and track it, go to the website teresalore.com. All of this, and it's going, just wait, we haven't gotten to the 16-year-old girl. That's coming. All of this leads to questions about Teresa Martin's possible socialization and involvement in the biker world. Despite everything we're told to the contrary, she's a good Catholic schoolgirl. She's got no bike gang associations. Doubts always linger in the mind, yeah? And I would suggest to you that a lot of this bias lies in some of the myths we've been told over the years about gang and biker culture. And one such myth is that gangs keep to their own. The circle of violence they commit is within their own subculture. Civilians don't get hurt. All of this stuff to which myself and everyone who lives in Montreal's Hochelaga-Maisonneuve neighborhood would scream, tell that to 11-year-old biker bomb victim Daniel de Roches. So an example of this, of how an innocent could be caught up in this violence, right? We heard earlier, right, of a kid being stabbed over 40 times, it's an earlier episode, in a rivalry over a girl and two biker clubs. Again, so this idea that everything is insulated and happens within a vacuum and does not touch everyday society, to which I would say that not so. In August 1968, three Popeyes motorcycle gang members, crowbars in hand, stood outside the Kimberley and Ontario Metro exit, waiting for a female victim, any female victim, to rob. The three struck 16-year-old Cégep student Christian Mallow repeatedly about the head. They ran off with Mallow's umbrella, her perfume, and 43 cents from her purse. Christian Mallow died 2 days later in a Montreal hospital. On October 15th, 1969, a month after Teresa Martin's murder, 16-year-old Michel Perrault was sentenced to life in prison, and the judge made the following comments. The police needn't be reticent in their handling of these motorcyclists who have ganged up together into criminal bands. They needn't wait until exhibits disappear or witnesses are threatened before moving to stop them. So as early as 1969, this judge, Jacques Anatil, could see what was coming, right? He could see the writing on the wall with these gangs. And like Christian Malot, I believe Teresa Martin was chosen at random by her biker attackers. Language has everything to do with this story. In the coroner testimony from the Martin case, at what point one of the girls says they all hung out at a restaurant, right, that served French fries. Except if you're French, it's pretty obvious that's not what she said. In French, she said the place served patates frites, right? But no one in English would know what I meant if I said fried potatoes. So I take some liberties and I call them French fries, right? Same way nobody in English calls it English trifle. They just call it trifle. And I suppose I could have used the word chips, but that probably would have made it even more confusing. The UK and Canada would have known what I was talking about. Nobody in the United States would have had a fucking clue what I was. Well, they would have thought, you know, I'm talking about like a bag of Utz, right? They hang out at the place that sells Utz potato chips. What the hell is this guy talking about? It's confusing. And language is confusing, but I think key to this case, particularly when you have a girl with an inscription on her abdomen when her body is found. Another word in this case, that you have to deal with is this word splash. The word splash is used much more in the Joanne H. Testimony. I changed some of that language to rape or fuck so people would know, you know, what the hell I was talking about. I had a really hard time tracking down its meaning. I went to several French friends in Quebec and none of them had heard of the term before. None of us are naive. We all guessed that it probably had like a sexual reference. It doesn't take much of an imagination to come to that conclusion. But I was really interested in its specific origin, its specific meaning. And I kept coming up empty. And then I found this Ottawa gang rape story. And that story gets us closer to the meaning that a splasher is a sex slave. But there may be, you know, I think its origin may have something even more precise than that. Lorraine Cotty also testified how before the gang rape started, this bitch's brew concoction of wine and beer was poured over the young victim before the sexual assault began. So I'd suggest to you that's the origin of splashing was a sort of bike gang rape ritual with any assault beginning with the full body dousing of alcohol. Just to drive this home, There's a social awareness piece from 1967 from the Windsor Star, which really spells out what splasher meant in bike culture. In 1967, a woman writer named Nancy Lugsden interviewed some women and girls affiliated with the Windsor, Ontario chapter of Satan's Choice. And this is a biker wife named Rebel's account of how women functioned in the biker world, in the early days of the biker world. Club members call married women old ladies. Well, we know that one, right? But hear me out. And the term also applies to girls who are going steady. If old ladies want, they can wear the club colors with the words "property of Satan's choice" and their boyfriend's name on it. This means private property, hands off to the other club members. Some of the girls, however, don't go with any member of the club, and they are called mamas or splashers. A splasher wears just the words "property of Satan's choice" on her jacket. "But you're ignorant if you do," said an old lady, explaining that this meant you were the club prostitute. Rebel goes on to say that when the boys threw parties where there was drinking involved, like the one that allegedly took place at the Merck Clubhouse, they usually left their old ladies behind because they didn't want anyone messing with their property. "Usually just splashers go to parties." Rebel also stated that the public's perceptions of bikers through movies is, quote, "pretty phony. All that rape and murder business. I've never heard of stuff like that." "I love you, French. I know it's important to you." So let's put it on the table. Did Michael French murder Teresa Martin? That's hard to justify if the only thing you have to go on is the inscription on her body using the word French. And as SQ profiler Mark Lepin suggested, what would French have been doing in Montreal North? As he put it, no affiliation with Montreal North. He was a West End thug. He operated at NDG, Point Saint-Charles, the Lachine area. Still, I would maintain that a biker goes where the action is. And the week of Teresa Martin's murder, Montreal North saw some action. On Wednesday, September 10th, 1969, this is 2 days before Martin's murder, there was a language riot in the neighboring community of St. Leonard. I'll say that again, a language riot. This is from the morning edition at the time of the Montreal Gazette. Last night, for the first time since 1949, the Riot Act was read as militant French unilinguists went on a wild window-smashing rampage along Jean Talon Street in suburban St. Leonard. And as would be the case with the Murray Hill riot, which would take place later the following month, in St. Leonard, the protests began as a focused demonstration, then quickly spiraled out of control into shop looting and burning of businesses and vehicles. Police made 50 arrests. A detachment of 500 Sûreté du Québec officers were called in to assist the local St. Leonard force. Hal Winter described the scene this way: At a corner, one of these young men grabbed a passerby and asked him, "Parlez-vous français?" "Mais oui," replied the shocked passerby. "Then," said his questioner, in an angry outburst of Italian, "this is for you." With that, he punched him in the mouth. Bad blood simmered for days. The situation didn't settle down until after the weekend. And I would note to you that you would have needed to travel through St. Leonard in order to get to the Galerie d'Anjou, the mall where Teresa Martin went to see a movie the night she died. So what might a Satan's Choice member like Mike French be doing in Montreal North at that time? The same thing any biker going to the scene of some chaos would be doing, to see what's going on, to exploit from that chaos, to profit from it. Further, Joanne H. described parties with the Montreal North bikers where splashers participated and splashing took place. The only biker group we know who used the term splashers, whether that was in Ottawa or Windsor or Montreal, were the Satan's Choice members. And Mike French was a member of Satan's Choice, as was this guy, Yvon Robert, who lived between the Martin's house and where Martin was found. So for the moment, hold those two ideas together, you know, in parallel. But consider this, if viewed in this light, French, I love you could be interpreted as a puzzling riddle with multiple meanings. It could be a reference to the victim. Teresa Martin was fluent in both French and English. It could be referring directly to the murderer, Mike French, or a murderer who wished to frame Michael French. It may have a broader, ironic meaning and be commenting on the cultural environment at that time, the frustrations and the anger that were boiling over in late 1969. You know, somebody might say to me, you know, but how could he say I love you when he murdered her? So, you know, people like the Boogaloo Boys weren't the first to invent irony. Ironic gestures were going on all that have been going on for ages, and particularly in the 60s. And we already saw the reference of the biker's kiss. They, in what can be interpreted as an act of irony, two males embrace and kiss passionately for the cameras to shock and also to imply confusing and opposite messages. This is no different from in that day, protesters wearing army and military flank jackets to say, "Well, you're protesting, but you're wearing a military uniform." It was an ironic gesture to comment on the situation. It is no different from me when I go cycling occasionally when I'm feeling feisty, riding around in a South Tete Quebec jersey. It has nothing to do with my support of the South Tete Quebec. It is a ironic gesture whose actual meaning holds meaning to no one but me. No one in the street understands why I'm doing it or gives a shit. But I would suggest to you, I love you French, right? I love you Frenchy. And the carving of those words had meaning held in irony. I don't know how else to say. It's, people are probably like, we get it, move on. My personal belief is that French I Love You was a warning. Teresa Martin was chosen at random, plucked off the streets as an innocent, and killed by bikers. The tattoo FL Frenchy I Love You left as a bleak warning to other young women in the neighborhood who were not so innocent and served as gang prostitutes, as drug runners, as maids. It was meant to be a warning of what happens to girls, any girl, who talks too much. In this context, Martin is a billboard, right? They pick a girl, any girl. They carve her up. They put her against the wall of the tavern where everyone can see her. You know, this idea would apply whether or not Mike French was the murderer. If it's a different biker, it's the same outcome, with the possibility that others, including gang girls, participated in the event. I freely admit there are problems with this theory. Chiefly, how does Teresa Martin get from the point where she's last seen, a bus stop in a secluded area, you might even call it a rural area at the time, part of Gouin Boulevard, how does she get from that area on Gouin to the tavern parking lot on Henri Bourassa? Someone didn't follow her off the bus. It's not that kind of a murder, right? And then you have, a guy on the bus, but also a guy in a car. How do we get to the car? So the next thing you kind of think of is, so a vehicle followed her and the bus from the Anjou Mall to the bus stop, gets off the bus, then they grab her. It's possible. It seems really improbable to me. Maybe the bus driver who said he saw her got it wrong. There's a lot that is wrong with this case. Martin was found without identification. As you know, she was not identified until her father saw her at the morgue. In the spring of 1970, detectives showed up at the Martin's door with Teresa Martin's wallet. We don't know where the wallet was found. Did someone find it on Henri Bourassa between Tavern Vieux Cypress and the Merck hangout in Anjou? Did someone find it in a field along Gouin Boulevard, then turn it into police? Knowing that would be helpful, just as knowing where my sister's wallet was found eventually led to not some random college campus killing, but a sexual predator known at that time to local police. In 2017, I made a FOIA request to the Montreal police for any correspondence concerning Michael French. I've forgotten why specifically I was interested in French at that time. I suspect it had to do with the Sharon Pryor case. The SPVM had the audacity to respond that they didn't have any information concerning Michael French. Such are the abuses of the Freedom of Information Act. I've posted the letter on the website as a curio. One final thought in all of this. In that coroner interrogation of Joanne H., her interrogators try to get her to name names. "You don't have a name in your head?" she's asked. And she responds, "Maybe I had one." Earlier in her testimony, she stated, "I know this is important to you." And the coroner asks, "What is important?" Joanne H. responds, "I love you, French." She doesn't say Frenchie. She says French. So, is it possible police missed that Joanne H. secretly named Teresa Martin's murderer? This is who killed Teresa. some housekeeping. If you like the podcast, go to iTunes, give it a 5-star rating and some words. Be much appreciated. Follow us on social media. We're on Twitter. We're on Facebook. We're on Instagram. And you can find all of those links at the website. Again, teresalore.com, teresalore.com. A little inside baseball. The whole section on splashing splasher, that didn't come about. I didn't have that in this. That didn't come about until the day before, like 2 days ago. And I wasn't looking for it. I was actually trying to do some fact-checking on something else, and I landed on those pieces, and I missed them originally because they weren't in the Quebec papers. They were in the Ontario papers. Totally kind of fell on my lap. Serendipitous investigative tools. Later this week, I'll post an interview I did with CrimeCon UK. They've done a great thing. They've done a series of podcasts promoting true crime podcasts in preparation for the CrimeCon convention in London. I believe that's September 25th and 26th. I'll be there. I'm fully vaccinated. I fully intend to come to London. It'll be a kick. This is quite something. So I did an interview about 6 weeks ago. I forget what I said, but I tried to keep the content. Tried not to talk about anything than we talk about on this podcast. It's great company. A lot of you listen to these other podcasts that I don't have time to listen to, quite frankly. But I've heard some episodes, and they're people I respect. UK True Crime, Mens Rea, Morbidology, The Unseen, True Crime Investigators, Sally and John. And I think, independent podcasts are the spirit of radio. And I'm fortunate that I get to do it, and... The only trade-off is you gotta listen to a couple of crappy commercials, and that's it. The moment my message gets co-opted is not gonna be a great day for me. I'm quite content to do what I do within the limitations of what it is. Occasionally I get off into policy, but it's really about delivering information and creating awareness. And if I start to rise above that, I don't think it's really great. If I start lending my voice to a policy or let somebody else use what I talk about to elevate a policy, I can't control that. But I'm not going to do it willingly for anybody's cause. I don't want a Megan's Raw law, a Ryan's Law, Gene Cleary Act thing, Teresa's Law. I don't really care about that. And I really believe in keeping the ambition simple, and independent podcasting makes that possible. So I'm really, I'm really happy to. Really happy to do it. I can't remember how I was going to segue into this, but I did want to say, we talk about historical crimes and all that, and we can talk about this week's episode and go, well, 50 years ago, that's the way it's done. We're all so much smarter now. Women would never be exploited and manipulated like that today. The point is, they knew they were being exploited and manipulated then. That's the point. They weren't naive. If you listen to Lorraine Cotty's testimony, she knows exactly the game. That's not some prosecuting attorney whispering in her ear when she says we're treated just like pigs. That's Lorraine, and she knew the game. So we like to think that we're so much more enlightened now. It's not that we're not. It's that they weren't naive about what was going on, but it was much more a man's world, much more. And you can see in that it's very rare to have so much perspective from a woman. I was very fortunate to find those. You know, when the rape of that girl by Bernie Gordon and his associate, it barely registered in Montreal. It's a blip. It's a little tiny notice. And it basically says, you know, some bad guys were charged with assaulting a girl and they were sentenced. End of story. You know, it doesn't go into detail. You know, and they use the excuse, well, it's too graphic, but that's not really what's going on, right? When they drop charges from rape to assault, they obscure and devalue the offense against the victim, and I think that's important. And anyway, that's, you know, all of that is to wrap it in to say independent podcasting is the spirit of radio. Like back in the day when you turned on FM, you never knew what was coming. And that's the beauty of what we get to listen to with all these disparate voices from Ireland and the UK and the US and Canada. It's really kind of a golden moment, and listeners and podcasters should really cherish it. Is there anything else I need to say? There's that crow. He's telling me to leave. he's like, time's wrap it up. That's what he wrap it up. Wrap it up, John. Crow's waiting. Just wrap it up. All right. As always, life isn't fair. Justice is blind and dysfunctional, and some cops aren't smart and dedicated like on television. I'm your host, John Allure. This has been Who Killed Teresa? Have yourselves a great, great day.